Okay, so welcome to the second part of the tutorial. Today we will have a look at how to connect to a server and get some data. And also first we have to have a look at conduits. So what are conduits and why are they useful? So conduits are useful for streaming data. And we have an input stream coming in, a binary stream, which delivers satellite telemetry, and we just want to decode that and view that for now. So if you have, for example, the idea of in Unix, you can do something like a cat file.txt something, then pipe it to a sort, then pipe it to unique, which makes that the lines are unique, and then count the lines in the file, for example. So this is some kind of pipeline. So with conduits, you can do the same, but in Haskell, but with a type safe with in mind, and so you can pass special data types data along in pipeline, and each step of the pipeline can transform it or do something with the data, and you can do this in a constant memory, so you don't have to load a whole file or a whole big data into memory and then process it at once. So you can do this stepwise. So if you can do some incremental processing, conduits are a very good thing. There are several libraries which can do this. One is Conduit, one is Pipes. There is also Streamly and IOStreams, and I don't know many others. You can do this with most of them. I use Conduit because, for example, Pipes was designed with equational reasoning in mind, and Conduit was designed with proper resource management and deallocation when something happens, for example, exceptions or something like that. As we have an IO-driven application, that's why I use Conduit. So to have a little bit of an overview, Conduit basically is a monotransformer. So you have a type. The evil monotransformer, the evil M word, don't care for now. So you have a conduit, T is the type, and then we have an input type, an output type, a monad, and a return type. And the thing is, so if you imagine as a pipeline stage, it gets some input, which is a data type, then it produces some output, which is a data type, and then it runs on top of some kind of monad. This could be an IO monad, could be a monad transformer stack, whatever. And then it can return a value. Yeah. So for now, let's say it returns unit, so no real value. And so then we can have different things. So for example, we could have just a pipeline stage, which would have this type. And then we could have something like a conduit T, which gets a unit as the input, then produces an output M, and this is basically a source or a producer. So it doesn't get some input from upstream, it only produces output. So this is, let's call it a source, and then we could also have the other way. This is a sink or a consumer, which is a conduit T, which does take some input but produces no output, and in this case conduit has chosen to use the void data type to indicate this. We don't care about the details for now. This is then a monad and something like that. And then what you can do with this is, if you have concrete instances, then you can have a source, then you pipe it into the pipeline stage and pipe it into the sink. And then you have a conduit chain, a processing chain. So very simple. The only difference to the Unix writing is that you have this dot pipe operator. And that's it. So that's quite cool, that's convenient, and so we want to use that. So how this looks internally, yeah, just a very, very quick overview how such a conduit could look like. So let's say this is a conduit T, which is input, output M, and doesn't return so anything. So what we want to do is, for example, waiting for some data from upstream, process it, and then pass it on downstream. And this is the most generic what you can do. So there is this await primitive. It awaits and gets your data from upstream. And this X is then maybe value. So if you have just some input, And this input value is of type I. That's important to note. Then we do something. And if we get a nothing. So, and if we have nothing, this means that upstream has closed the pipeline. So we should also, the most sensible thing is to do like this. And in this case, for example, we didn't have some kind of transformation. Let output, in this kind of the case, I just do some simple pure transformation. So do something to input, and this do something would have a type I to O in this case, and to pass the value on downstream you call yield output, and then you have to close the loop, so you call example, you call this function again that you have to loop. If you have something in this structure, there is a convenience function. You can also write that example 2, we can write it quite quickly. There is a function which does basically this, this which is called wait forever, and then you get the input and yield. Yield do something input. And as this is a lambda function, we can also shorten this a little bit. We can yield do something like that. Yeah, that's short. The thing is, if you have a structure like this, it's good to use the wait forever. It's just a convenient thing. But if you have parameters which you need to pass a change and need to pass again, and you have to have this loop, or you have to have bailout otherwise, then you need this structure. So this is just for the basic understanding. Okay. We want to basically to connect to the network. So let's first have a look at the test data. And oh my god, that's the color. Ooh. So you see, this is very clearly binary data. We have no idea what is inside. You see a lot of 55 hex values. I know what this is, but yeah, we will have to have a look what we actually have inside of this file. So currently we know nothing about this. Yeah. So the first thing is we want when we connect to a server, and then we get data which looks like this. Binary data. So let's first start to somehow connect to a server. For testing, we could also use a file conduit and just attach the conduit to this file and then pass it into the pipeline. But we want to have this as a network application and not as a file application. So it's just remote. And the thing is, let's see. I'll just remove this for now. And so let's have a look at what we have. So this is the conduit library, and we need have a look. Fortunately, for connecting, we have already conduits available in the conduit extra package. So if we have a look, so we have here the conduit network, which sounds good. So you have here a source socket on this in the sync socket, for example, if you want to create manually here. And then this takes some input and delivers the byte strings, so the raw binary data from the socket. And the sync, of course, takes the byte string and streams it out to the socket. And then you have a TCP server client interface, so the server settings are not, we will be a client So we have this is the client section. So we have a run general TCP client. We pass it some client settings, and the client settings have a port. So client settings can be generated with a port number and a host name. And then a callback function which takes an app data and it processes something in the monad, and this is then run. Yeah. So basically here, this here will be our conduit pipeline. And yes, so for the first thing, we have this client settings. Let's quickly change to here. So we want to import data conduit network, I think. And we have of course this output here, but sometimes I just want to have GCID running. If you have a larger project, sometimes SQL Language Server is not that precise and takes a lot of time until it gets to where it should be. So in another project where I have multiple libraries, it doesn't get there. So I have sometimes a GCID running in the background. Let's see. We are all good. Very good. So remove this. So we need to have some settings. These are client settings. And for now, we specify port number, which is 2542. And host name, in this case, localhost. And I think in the next session, we will create a configuration for this. So, because now it's hard-coded. And then we have a run TCP. Let's have a look. I always forget this. So, run general TCP client. Run general TCP client settings. And then we have a function which takes app data. And this should do something. And let's now call this undefined. So it compiles. So this is good. What shall we do here? Actually, we want to read from this socket. So let's go again here. And we want to have this. We get this app data structure. Yeah. So run general TCP client. We get this app data and have to use that. So we have this app data here, and we have a source. And this source, we give it this app data, and then it produces byte strings. So this is called app source. Just let's copy that. So let's define a conduit pipeline. Or let's do it for now. Let's do it directly here, which is app source. We gave it this app data, and then it produces byte strings. So what shall we do with the byte strings? So for now, I just want one thing. I just want to get the length of the byte string to see what we get actually. So just how many bytes? Yeah. So let's say byte string length conduit. I call it like this for now, which is a conduit T, which takes as an input the byte string. It doesn't return anything, so this is a sync. Runs in a monad, doesn't return anything, and await forever. So we get a byte string, and what we want to do is we want to print the byte string length of this, right? So, and now we get some errors. So first, not in scope or constructor class conduit T. Well, this is easy to fix. We want to have conduit. Then we don't have the length. Yes, of course. So we qualified real byte string SBS. Okay, then we don't have print. Yes, of course, yeah. Don't have to know. Let's do it otherwise. T put through line And then we need to tpack. Let's make this now. This is now really, really ugly, but just for the quick look. So we get the length of the byte string, which is then probably an int or something like that. Then we show this into a string, then we pack it into a text, and we put it out with tpackStringLine. And of course, we don't have pack then, so we also import qualified real text as t. And if you wonder why we have data text IO, if we have real text, the thing is the IO functions of text are not exported by real. So we have to do this extra. And then we have with actual type IO, yes, right. So because we are in the conduit T, which is a monad transformer, and we are here in the M, this is some kind of monad. So, but this is function is in putStringLine, has the type text in IO. Yeah, so we need to put this into IO. So we, for this case, we have to lift this IO function into the context of the conduit T. And this is simple by doing lift IO. So remove this and we're good. Perfect. So now we want, of course, to pipe this. So AppSource now connects. So the run is here. Okay. Step back. The run general TCP client connects to a server. This app source is then a conduit which produces byte strings, reads as many as it can, and if it doesn't get them, it blocks and waits for the next data. And we now want to pass these byte strings to our conduit, to a piece length 3, which just puts out the length of the byte strings. Yeah. And because this is, we need to run this conduit somehow. So this run TCP client doesn't run automatically the conduit. So what we do here is run conduit res. I think that should it. Ah, yeah, okay. Since we are, what we forgot, we need a monad IO constraint. And we're good. Perfect. So run conduit res is the run function for the conduit T monad transformer, yes? And res means with resources. So it internally wraps it with a resource T and handles this socket, which is a resource automatically for us. So we don't need to care about this. This is just for, so for other conduits, we could run them also with run conduit alone. But now we want to have also the resource cleanup and have to do this. So this compiles. So the thing is, now would be interesting to see stack run tutorial telemetry to see what we get. And we compile and we run. And oh no, of course we get a connection refused exception. Why? Because we haven't set up a server socket which listens on this port we specified here. Yeah. The application then terminates. This throws an exception and terminates. Depending on your kind of application, this could be exactly what you want, or this could be something you don't want. And in my case, I don't want this. So what I want is that if you cannot connect, it should wait a little bit and then try to reconnect again. Yeah. So what we do here is then we catch this exception. So we try this and then we get a result and try catches the exception and converts it into either left exception or right. In this case, it will be unit probably, but anyway, so case res of left, and then we need to have some kind of exception. We need to specify the type of it because otherwise it will, so it's probably an IO error or something like that. I'm not sure. Let's see if this would run. And in this case, what shall we do? We shall do, which we put as t put through line. We could not connect, let's say, could not connect, reconnecting, something like that. And then we should, of course, repeat this thing. So actually, connect client, let's put this into a function and then just connect client again, right? And in the case of write, and we don't care what it is, we should only, the only thing we can do is probably terminate. So this will run and block as long as we have data. And if the connection goes down, we could also try to again try to reconnect. Actually, yeah, let's do this. So if the connection is closed, then we want to again reconnect. Maybe, yeah, let's, for now, let's do it like this. Last statement in a do block must be an expression. Of course, yeah, and so now we have this defined this function with a let expression, but we haven't called it actually. So connect client, and then most probably we'll get some other errors. Type IO error, blob. Okay, for now, this is also just a quick click. Okay, this is wrong. This is a typo, and we're good. So let's try this. Compile. And it runs. Oh, yes. And of course, what we have forgotten is for reconnecting, we want to could not connect reconnecting. So what we do want to do is, of course, we want to wait sometime. otherwise, this is an endless loop. So we do this with thread delay, and let's say 2 seconds. And the time for thread delay is to be specified is in microseconds. And this is where this extension numeric underscores comes in, because if you don't have this, these 1,000 separators, it's easy to mess the numbers up. So that's quite handy. And the thing is, it now use numeric underscores, it says this here, but we have it as a default value in the COBOL file. Yeah. So didn't Haskell language server didn't get this. So anyway, so now run it again. Couldn't connect reconnecting, couldn't connect reconnecting. So now let's see. We get into tutorial telemetry. Yes, so we are here into the test data. So our application still tries to connect. Yes. And we now want to, we have this binary dump file here, and we want to pass this on. So we do this very quickly. So we cut this file and then pipe it into netcat. Netcat just is a very simple tool. We say it should listen on a port, and then the port 2502. This is the port we specified before. This is a standard telemetry port for certain mission control systems. And so we call this, let's see. And you see, we have got the length of byte strings. So there's quite some stuff in this file. So we have about 16 kilobytes we got, then we have 65 kilobytes we got in one go, then we have 131 kilobytes we got in one go. So this file contains quite some telemetry. But then we also have some smaller things where we only get 53 bytes. Yeah. But anyway, yeah, it's a success. We already have now streaming data from a socket. And we just print the length of these byte strings we get here. So let's conclude for now, for this time part of the video. And we'll continue then afterwards. Current status of this session will be on GitHub in the repository. And if you want to follow along, just have a look at it. So thanks.